It's my feel good breakfast show.
Welcome back, beautiful souls, and we are about to kick it with another installment of the Culinary Hotline Blink.
Ting, ting, ting. Wait, yeah. I don't know. The synchronicity.
The synchronicity is out here. We need to do it again. Okay. Everybody, you ready for another installment of the Culinary Hotline Blink?
Ting, ting, ting! That was better. That was better.
Kicking. All right, so Chef Clem is here once again as our foodie panel expert this morning to help us out with any answers or any culinary conundrums that we have in the kitchen. And of course, if you want to ask us, you can use the line 021-110-5552. Yeah, and then we'll be coming through for you. All right, guys, so what is that? Straight into it. All right, okay. Well, let's serve. Good morning, we are here to serve the answerer of answers, the killer of conundrums. How can I help you this morning? Hello?
Hello.
Good morning, how are you?
Okay, and you?
I'm fantastic now that I'm chatting to you, but I don't know what your name is yet. Who can I ask is calling?
My name is Elizabeth.
Elizabeth, good morning, how are you?
Finding you.
I'm fantastic. So what is your question for the specialist himself, Chef Clem? What do you have for our conundrum this morning?
My question was that I want to know what shallot is.
What is a shallot? Are you saying shallot?
Shallot, yeah.
Yes. Okay, well, clearly shallot. You and I both have no idea what that is. So, Chef Clem, you got to come through here. A shallot?
I heard carrot, and then I was like, how am I going to explain what it is? But a shallot, okay. Or some people pronounce it shallot. Let's talk about it. So it comes from the allium family.
Allium.
The allium family, let's just call it the onion family.
Okay.
Let's talk about a few of the members of the allium family. So it includes garlic, all right, spring onions,
okay,
and leeks. Yeah. And then you obviously have a normal, regular white onion,
yeah,
purple onion, and then this guy,
weird
the shallots. The shallots.
Is that what it is?
That's what it is. So let's just talk about flavor-wise. Garlic, we know the flavor that we get from garlic. If you want to get more subtle flavor from garlic, you can roast it. Roasting garlic brings out the sweetness out of it.
Okay.
We know that. Spring onions are really great because when you use onions in a dish, you have to cook the onions down to bring out the flavor.
Mm-hmm.
Spring onions, you don't have to cook them down. So instead of doing 15 minutes cooking time, 5 minutes is all you need.
All right.
Some people say that red onion is sweeter than white onion.
I kind of do get that every now and then.
A little bit sometimes.
I think it's the color that kind of throws you off more.
The color kind of throws you off there. And but I genuinely, if I do have to use a raw onion in a salad or something, I will go red just because I know maybe it's a little less intense in onion flavor.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the shallots.
Because I'm sure Elizabeth out in Soweto would love to know how she can maybe use this in a dish or cook with it. So what are we talking about when it comes to flavor and everything else in this?
It's sweet. This is sweeter than a normal onion.
A sweet onion.
It's sweeter onion. You can use this raw as well. It's also been said that they were kind of bred, you know, not genetically modified, but kind of like you can breed seeds together to get a beautiful shape like this to make it easier for chefs to work with.
Okay.
Which makes a lot of sense. You can kind of see that. So let's just cut through the onion. And you can see same thing's got the layer. It's like people. They have layers. Okay.
And is it the more that you get to know them and the more you extract those layers, you get to the core and the good stuff? Is it
true story also? You get to the core, the inner part of the onion, it's sweeter.
Okay, all right.
Like people.
Yeah,
you gotta
Sometimes we uncover those layers and we don't always get the...
Sometimes it's a picky fraud.
Yeah.
But let's bring the conversation back. Okay.
Keep it on the sweet stuff.
So what I like doing is, I'm going to also use it in a recipe now, is shallots and red onions, I like actually grating them and using it with like meats or even some vegetables. But the thing with meats is it helps tenderize the meat, adding moisture and adding flavor. We don't grate onions enough. A lot of Indian recipes, Middle Eastern recipes, they grate their onion first, and that's exactly what we're gonna do today.
All right, show us how it's done, brother.
Okay, but I've got to work it in, though. That's gonna be part two.
So what I'm gonna do
is I'm gonna start grating my shallots to actually use it. We're gonna make...
So we're actually gonna use this in a meal? Is that what's happening?
We're gonna use it to put together a whole big meal. Does it sound like a good idea?
Yeah, it sounds like a fantastic idea. And I think Elizabeth's gonna appreciate this as well. I don't know if she's still on the line, but she will be watching along with the rest of Ms. Hansi to figure out how we utilize this awesome shallot in a meal, right?
Absolutely.
Sweet.
Yes. So let's just talk about, we had another question, so I thought, let me tie shallot question in with the next question. So the other question we had was how to make pita breads. I love that. Pita breads.
From scratch?
From scratch, Middle Eastern. I need a Middle Eastern recipe. Let's talk about the pita breads and get that going first before we start working on the shallots. So, Same story as making a normal bread. Now, we've got some warm water over here. We're going to add our yeast to it.
Yeast?
And we're going to start blooming that yeast, activating that
yeast. Is the yeast to make it rise?
We need it to rise. Yes. It is a yeast leavened bread.
Okay.
And so we're giving it some sugar, and you're going to see, you're going to give it a few seconds, and it's going to start feeding on the sugar, and it gives off alcohol, carbon dioxide. Don't worry about the alcohol, that just evaporates, but you get that lift and that rise and that texture and the smell. You can smell it already.
Yeah, definitely.
That comes through from blooming the yeast.
Okay.
So once you give it a few, literally I let this sit for about 10 minutes, and you'll see all those bubbles sitting on the top. I'm fast-forwarding now because I don't have enough time to do that.
So let's pretend it's all fully bloomed
now. Pretend.
Yeah.
A little bit of olive oil going in. That's just going to help us work with it a lot easier. Then,
right.
But the salt goes in now. You don't want to add the salt in the beginning because yeast doesn't like salt. Like sugar, loves sugar.
Keep it out of the blooming process.
Exactly. Keep it out of the blooming process. Then the rest of the water goes in.
And is it warm water, you said?
You can feel the temperature of that. It's just about lukewarm.
Just right.
Just right.
Just right.
And then you don't want to go too hot, Goldilocks, or else you're going to kill the yeast. So just right.
Okay.
That's exactly what you want.
Okay.
So now, the thing about bread, it's a waiting game. The ingredients are very simple, but it's all about waiting, okay? You have to let the flour hydrate, you have to let it rise, and it takes time.
Okay.
So, what looks like a very, very wet dough, you're going to start working your flour into your water.
It literally looks just like a smoothie right now.
Right,
is that going to change?
It does. It is going to change. Think about it. So the flour, as we know, it sounds like a silly thing to say, but the flour is dry.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Even when you mix it into a dough, there's still a bit of, like, dryness in there. You have to give the flour time to hydrate, to suck up all that moisture.
Yeah.
And to start forming its texture. So like, you can see already, it's not a smoothie anymore.
I see, so it's already getting thick.
And that's you're going to keep on working
harder.
It. Keep on kneading it like this, and the longer you keep on kneading it, you're developing the gluten, number one, and number two, you're getting that flour hydrated. So already, it's come together as a nice dough. You're going to keep on working it, and believe it or not, it actually comes out looking like that.
No, but I can see that. I mean, it's only been in a minute, and you're already kind of getting close to what that
it
looks
is.
Like.
And like I said, it's going to keep on hydrating. It's going to end up being a beautiful soft dough like this. What we're going to do is fast forward again. It has to rest, okay? That proving process.
So the key to making bread, it seems, is that you can't rush it, right?
You can't rush it. You need to give that a feel. Super, super, super soft.
Oh, that's awesome. Soft, really malleable right now.
It
you
is.
Can do a lot with that.
So we're going to divide this into little balls, get your balls going. Then you're going to start rolling them out into shapes like we know, recognize as pita breads.
Yes.
But then we're going to get this in the pan. So I'm going to get this in the pan so long while I work on.
I thought you put these in the oven and
you can.
Oh, okay, so you can do that. All right.
You can. You just get it better. I believe you get a better texture when you do it in the pan.
Mm.
You get a better crust on your pita bread. And you get a bit of flavor-wise. There's a reason we like toast more than we like normal bread. Toasting the flour and then getting the extra flavor. You toast it better when it's in a dry pan like that.
Ah, that does make sense. And then that cast iron to work with the flour just kind of gives it that beautiful sort of authenticity you get from like a grill or something as well.
And you don't have to use cast iron. If you don't have cast iron, I totally get that. But what you do want is a nice heavy-based bottom pan.
Okay,
so all we're doing, you can go perfectly round, but I kind of like a little bit of an oval
shape. This is where
shape.
You could get creative, of course.
I mean...
You can create your own shapes if you don't like the traditional sort of, what is it, an oblong oval of some sort?
You can, absolutely. So let's just go with this little bit of an oval. I think that's pretty cool. What you want to do at this stage is when you get this rolled out like this, you can let it sit for like 5 minutes just to give it another chance to relax a bit.
This is waiting game, patience in between this.
But what's really nice is by the time you've rolled that out, you've got one in the pan. So it's time to turn over. And you're going to turn this over.
Oh, you see, you've got
you
the crisp
starting to happen.
Good.
You're going to turn it over about 6 times.
Okay.
And during that time, when you form that crust on the outside, you keep on turning over, you've then formed a crust on both sides. So what you're left with is this air pocket in the middle. So it's going to start separating. So when you cut it open, okay, this one, these we made earlier this morning.
And you cut it open, and then you've just got that like sort of center just waiting to be plumped.
You see?
With all the good stuff.
Look at that.
Okay. I was
wondering
how they did this so perfectly. Now it makes sense.
Now it makes sense. So all about turning over and keep on going, keep on turning over, forming that crust, and you get this beautiful airy inside, which is ready for your next part of your recipe, which we're going to use our shallots for.
Oh, yes. And, of course, that recipe can be found on expressoshow.com. We're going to be making it. You guys can check it out so long so you can get your ingredients ready. And once you've got the ingredients, you can join us and start making something beautiful. We've already done the naan bread. We've got our, what do you call these onions again? I keep forgetting.
Shallot.
And that was a question from Elizabeth. So thank you for coming through all the way from Soweto on that. And if you've got any more questions, give us some of your conundrums. If we want to share the kitchen fails, then call us right now. It's 021-110. 0800-555-2552, and we'll be coming straight back at you with some more solutions. See you soon. It's my feel-good breakfast show. Welcome back, you beautiful souls. You know what time it is, of course. We're back in the kitchen, we're back doing the thing. Chef Clem and I are just about to sanitize because we're bringing you the final installment of the Culinary Hotline Bling! Ching, ching, ching! And if you have any questions for Chef Clem and all things in the kitchen, or you just need help getting out of those sticky foodie situations, or maybe you have a winter dessert that you want to share with us, well, let us know. Of course, you can get us on the line, 021-110-5552, and we are picking up where we left off. We're busy making, what were we making? Pita breads, right?
Pita breads, yeah.
Yeah, pita breads. We got some shallot, which was like, I loved what she, hey, when that sound rings, we stop what we're doing and we're here to serve. Let's find out who's on the line. Good morning, you beautiful soul. Thank you for phoning the answer of answerers. This is the Chef Clem and Ryle show. How are you doing this morning? Who may I ask is speaking?
Good morning, Raoul. Good morning, Chef Clem. It's Sandra Fabry from Cape Town.
Sandra! Sandra, you're like family. I don't even need to ask. It's so good chatting to you again. What is the question that you have for our beautiful Chef Clem over here?
Hi, Chef Clem. You're busy making the pitas. Now, I would like to know, will it have the same pocket effect if I put some chopped biltong in it? Because I love biltong.
Inside the pita as a filling or in the dough?
No, in the dough.
Sandra, I like you. You fancy, hey? I see how you're doing it. Not just any pita, but a Sandra pita. Can you add biltong into the dough?
You can.
Okay.
So I would suggest you use the biltong dust, or if you want to just blitz up your biltong
for
in like a blender,
pieces.
Make it smaller.
Okay.
You can add it to your dough process. The only time I would be wary is if you had to add moisture to a dough. Then you're kind of like messing with the ratios.
Okay.
But if you're adding like dry biltong to it, yes. And I can imagine that'll be so nice served with like a little bit of like cream cheese and spring onion.
Oh, Sandra, you just got us on to...
Yeah.
Sandra, the next question I have for you is clearly you're going to have to make this. So when are we going to get to taste your new pitas? When are you going to pop this recipe into creation?
You must taste my biltong pasta.
Wow. Okay, so are you Sandra's like a
cream.
Are you like a biltong specialist? What else have you done with biltong?
I'm a biltong addict.
I love it. I love that. And I mean, who can go?
I sleep and love biltong.
Nice. And especially being a South African tradition, I love that. I love it.
Keeping it local.
Well, Sandra, thank you so much for calling in, and thank you for...
Whoa!
The lines are popping off. All right, let's see who this is. Hello and good morning, you beautiful soul. How may I help you? This is Raoul speaking from the Culinary Kitchen. Who may I ask is calling?
Hello, Clem Chef. Is that you?
Is Chef Clem and Raoul's assisting him? Who may I ask is calling?
Hello, Clem Chef. This is Rosalind speaking. I make biscuits, you know, butter biscuits and chop biscuits. But a few hours afterwards, the biscuits go soft. How can I make crisp? Biscuit, please help me.
Clem, okay, the chef, you've got to come through.
You made a butter biscuit, and what other biscuit did you say you made?
And I make chok chip biscuits. And macadamia oat biscuits.
Okay, so I can tell you the first thing with the macadamia and the oat one. Macadamia is very oily, and oats absorb oil, and then the oats themselves become very oily. So when it comes to macadamia and oat biscuits, what you're going to do is you need to add more of a dry agent, so more flour to it. But generally, macadamia and oat biscuits are a little softer, a little chewier, so that's okay. What I am thinking is a bit concerning is that your butter biscuits are coming out soggy. So what's happening there is you're adding too much fat. So you need to take some of the fat out, some of the butter out, or add more flour to it. So it's your ratio between your flour and your fat. And like that, if you want a choc chip cookie that's more gooey and chewy, you add more fat to it. And if you want one that's more shorter, that has a bit of a snap, you add more flour. So it's just your ratios. And we actually have some recipes on the Expresso website. Go and check out our butter biscuits, shortbread biscuits, and our chocolate chip cookies. And you see those ratios are perfect when it comes to baking cookies and biscuits.
That. Okay, Rosalind, I hope that answers your question.
Thank you, Chef Clem. I will try the recipe again.
And what I can suggest
you.
Is, not last week, but the week before, we made the Skit Your Biscuit recipe with Carl Hasty. By the way, shout out to the barber, my barber, that's his recipe. So that shortbread biscuit recipe that we use for Skit Your Biscuit, that's a good butter biscuit recipe. So go and make that biscuit, make that dough, and you'll still get a nice, beautiful snap out of that.
I love that. And Rosalind, if you do end up making those beautiful biscuits again, please tag us in the pictures, send it through to us, because we'd love, love, love to see what you do and see if Chef Clem was able to... Is that another... Was it? Okay, just...
Are you just hearing phones?
The phone's just going crazy. I'm just ready to answer everything. Mzansi, come through, of course. You know what our line is. But we need to finish off our recipe,
right,
Clem, because we got the pita bread on lock. We did the shallot.
So let me tell you what I did with it.
What's next?
I took the shallots and I actually just grated it, okay? Like I said, grating onions is a really great way... It's a great way to use it. Okay.
Well played.
So there we go. So in here, I've got some lamb mint, some salt, mint, and parsley. I'm going to add the onion to it. So it's going to add flavour, of course, but it's also going to tenderise the meat, as like the liquid from the onions gets mixed in with the meat,
like,
you know?
Playing with each other, yeah, of course.
Then another allium going in there, garlic.
Okay.
And I love garlic, so go wild
what
with this.
What about the
one.
Alliums today? I didn't know what that was until today.
I know,
so
allium, alliums. Yeah. And pepper going in. Then, normally people add breadcrumbs to their meatballs. Oh, wait, by the way, we're making lamb meatballs. Did I say that?
I don't think we said that. By the way, lamb meatballs are going in this pita. That's what Chef Clem is showing us how to do right now. And of course, you can get this recipe on expressoshow.com too for all the inspiration you need. Where are we at with this one, though?
Okay, so like I said, people add breadcrumbs or eggs to it. It's not necessary. What I do is I add the Willy's garlic and chili pasta stir through sauce. It's delicious. It's amazing.
So much work as well. That's like a perfect flavor variety.
All the spices
over there
are in there. Yeah. Everything's done already for you. So here's why we sanitize, because I'm going to get my hands in there now. And your hands are the best tools in the kitchen. So you can kind of like work that mince, make sure you're getting all the ingredients mixed together. And what you're going to do is you're going to shape them into little balls. And you can do this like on a kebab skewer or over a braai, but you're not probably going to just start a braai just to make some meatballs. So bring out your griddle pan. Get it nice and hot, and we're gonna char them. While I'm doing that, will you make a quick slaw for me? Very quick.
I got you. What do you need?
Purple cabbage, carrots, lemon juice, that's it. That's all you need.
Okay, all right. Sounds easy enough.
We got some things to kind of mix it together there.
Yeah, I've got everything I need while you get onto your bowl making business on the other side. And I'm just stirring this up, Chef Clem.
That's it. So I'm gonna get these little you can make these into burgers if you wanted.
Ooh, now you're being naughty. Now you're being naughty. I like that. But I think at the same time, like you said, this is where you can get a bit creative. Small balls, big balls, flat balls, whatever you name it.
However tennis
you
like baller,
you like
cricket baller.
This is how you can make it.
Anyone. Our Afrikaans is not amazing, as if you like could tell earlier from Graham.
What do you mean, bro? It's net save Afrikaans in the kitchen. In the kombase. Yeah.
In the kombase. In the kombase. Okay, so we're going to get those going. Clean up hands again, and now we're gonna fill it. Super simple. So we've used our shallots, we've grated it to make this mince filling, and then we've got our beautiful pitas.
Simple yet so fresh and effective. I love this. I think it's gonna give the perfect balance to the acidities of the meat and some of the dough as well. So I cannot wait for this.
The worst thing is when you have too many fillings for your pita that you can't actually taste anything, and it's too full. Everything just pops out, goes flying everywhere.
That's how I like it, actually.
You do like it when
it's like
beautiful.
Yeah, it's like
I agree with you.
It just goes and falls to the plate, and then you're just scooping it back in. It's like eating twice.
I agree. Okay, actually I agree with you now. So then in we go with our meatballs. I wanted to get three in. Let's see. Let's get the rest of stuff. Okay.
Gonna be pushing it.
We're pushing it. So a little bit of the yogurt dressing. Just yogurt, actually. Just yogurt.
Just plain yogurt.
And I've used all my other herbs. If you had any leftover herbs, you can sprinkle that on top. Spring onion, this would be amazing.
Your alliums will go in there nicely.
The alliums.
Yes.
Feta. Love feta. Feta.
Making us, turning us into a little bit of a bougie meal this year.
It is. Now, just because I said I want to try and get three.
Because we can.
It's not necessary.
Three times the charm.
We are being a little extra right now. But it's so simple, and it's also an easy dinner to make. What's today? Wednesday. Do you need some midweek recipe inspiration? Pita breads are really simple to make, and because one pita bread is cut into two, you make two little pockets, everybody's happy. You don't need to go mince. You can do falafels. Vegetarians are going to be happy. Pitas are what you need to be making for dinner tonight.
I think it is the perfect macro balance as well. You've got great carbs, protein, and fat coming from all the ingredients in this variety. It's a live meal that's fun to make. Of course, you saw how easy it was with Chef Clem and I. I couldn't even cook, and look how I was able to help.
You were amazing.
I think it's perfect. Thank you to everybody that phoned through again on our culinary hotline bling, but unfortunately, that's all the time we have for our hotline today. And if you have any culinary conundrums or you want to share your kitchen fails with us, then you can call us on the 021 110 555. 52, or of course our Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter pages, and of course our website expressoshow.com, where we have this recipe all laid out for you, A to Z. What more do you need? Come on, people! Beautiful stuff for Wednesday. We have served you. Well done, Clem.
Well done, you.